Lord, we need your grace and mercy in you. We need to pray.
Oh, so. To call me is very difficult. I went to some places, they'll tell me I'm old. To cut my story short, God wants me to work for him in this ministry. I thank God for blessing me that today I'm no more a bench warmer, I'm a worker. And secondly, I have something to do for myself, not to work for person. I thank God for the ministry like this. For their fellow, without their follow up, I would not be like this. And I continue to thank God. As long as I remain in this ministry, I'll humble myself to worship Him for the rest of my life. Praise the Lord.
I want to put on the fellow alone. Only that to be a known guest, eh? But to be clear, I want to put on the job. Iṣẹ́ ìrọ̀ṣẹ́ gbígbà yìí ó ní àwọn kan máa ń lọ sí ṣọ́ọ̀ṣì láti lọ jókòó lórí àga kí àga lè bá a lọ wọ́ọ́rọ́. Ṣùgbọ́n nígbà táwọn ṣe dé gbígbà yẹn àwọn darapọ̀ pẹ̀lú àwọn ẹ̀kọ́ ìbẹ̀rẹ̀pẹ̀pẹ̀. Lẹ́yìn ìgbà táwọn tún ṣe ẹ̀kọ́ ìbẹ̀rẹ̀pẹ̀pẹ̀ tán, àwọn ń ṣiṣẹ́ káàkiri pàápàá nílé ìgbafẹ́ tuntun wá dàbí ẹni tó fẹ́ mú wọn padà sẹ́yìn. Ṣùgbọ́n àwọn dúpẹ́ lọ́wọ́ Ọlọ́run lónìí. Nítorí pé Ọlọ́run ti ṣe ohun tó dára láyé wọn, àwọn ní ọ̀nà ọ̀fẹ́ láti máa ṣiṣẹ́ fún Ọlọ́run àti pàápàá Ọlọ́run fún wọn lórúkọ tiwọn.
I know. You are just an angel. that
have come to save this land.
Not
knowing that all that David was doing was just a pretender. The reality of it is not there. So today we are going to continue from there. 1 Samuel chapter 29. I'm going to take my reading from verse 9. And Achish answered and said to David, I know that thou art good in my sight as an angel of God. Notwithstanding, the princes of the Philistines have said, he shall not go up with us to the battle. Verse 10. Wherefore now rise up early in the morning with my master's servant, that I come with thee, and as soon as ye be up early in the morning and have light, depart. So David and his men rose up early to depart in the morning to return into the land of the Philistines. And the Philistines went up to
We don't need to look at what is going to be the subject of discussion for today.
What
is the topic of our discourse today? The mercy of God to David. If you ask me, I would say David is mercy personified. That means David himself is mercy. There are several occasions, several radical instances, the mercy of God has been so boundless and limitless in the life of David. David has been enjoying the mercy of God so much. Even when he is supposed to be destroyed, still go ahead and enjoy the mercy of God. So just like I have said, quickly before we go into the discourse, the 2 Samuel chapter 29 of today, I want to look at one account in the Bible that the mercy of God spoke to David. That God uses a woman to help David. That was the mercy of God. I'm going to look at it from verse 23. And when Abigail now saw David, she hastened and lightened off the ass and fell before David on her face and bowed herself to the ground and fell at his feet and said, upon me, my Lord, upon me let this iniquity be, and let thy handmaid, I pray thee, speak in thine audience and hear the words of thy handmaid. Let not, my Lord, I pray thee, regard this man of Belial, even Nabal. For as his name is, so is he. Nabal is his name, and fully is with him. But I, thy handmaid, saw not the young man of my Lord, whom thou hast sent. 26. Now therefore, my Lord, as the Lord liveth, and as I so liveth, seeing the Lord has withholden thee from coming to shed blood, and from avenging thyself with thy own hand, now let thy enemies, and they that seek evil to my Lord, be as Nabal. And now the blessing which thy handmaid hath brought unto my Lord, let it not be given unto the young men that follow my Lord. I pray thee, forgive the trespass of thy handmaid. For the Lord will certainly make my Lord a sure house, because my Lord fighteth the battles of the Lord, and the evil had not been found in thee all thy days. Yet a man is risen to pursue thee and to seek thy soul. But the soul of my Lord shall be bound in thy bundle of the life with the Lord thy God, and the souls of thy enemies then shall he slay out as out of the middle of a sling. Verse 30. And it shall come to pass, when the Lord shall have done to my Lord according to all the good that he hath spoken concerning thee, and shall have appointed thee ruler over Israel, that this shall be
that this shall be no grief unto thee, nor offense of heart unto my God, either that thou hast shed blood causeless, or that my Lord hath avenged himself. But when the Lord shall have dealt with my Lord, then remember thy handmaids. In fact, so David received of her hand that which she had brought him, and said unto her, go up in peace to thy house. See, I have hearkened to the voice and have accepted thy person. This Bible passage that we have read, Abigail here on her own, she was trying to intercede for the husband Nabal. Because David came to kill Nabal. Because Nabal has offended him. But Abigail, in her own intelligence, tried to intercede for the husband. But the mercy of God in this Bible passage that we have read, Abigail, in her intelligence, she did not know that she was trying to save David from shedding blood, from taking vengeance. For God hates anything that has to do with bloodshed. And God hates vengeance. Vengeance is mine. Vengeance is of the Lord and it is not of man. So Abigail here tried to save Nabal. But God used her to save David from being stained, from bloodshed. You can see there in verse 26 of that chapter 25. As Abigail was saying, she said that surely as the Lord liveth, and as you liveth, that the Lord God has decided to prevent you from bloodshed and from taking vengeance in your own hands.
Yes, sir. Can you give me
verse 30 and in verse 31. Verse 30 and 31. He says, remember, when the Lord God has fulfilled all that he has promised unto you, because you are a potential king. You will see to it that all that I have prevented you from shedding blood, from taking vengeance, it means your she shall be blameless. She shall be without blame. There shall be no stain of blood. There shall be no evil report concerning you. So your rulership is going to be a very good one. Because of no account do you have evil records in you. You can see the mercy of God here. Using Abigail intelligence to save David from being destroyed. For God hates hands that are being stained with blood. And he hates vengeance. So from where we have read today in 1 Samuel chapter 29. So what is the mercy of God to David in this Bible passage that we have read? I'm going to look at verse 3 of that 1 Samuel chapter 29, verse 3 and verse 4. Then said the princess of the Philistine, What do these Hebrews here? And Achish said unto the princess of the Philistine, is not this David, the servant of Saul, the king of Israel, which hath been with me these days and this year, and have found no fault in him since he fell unto me unto this day. Verse 4. And the princes of the Philistines were wroth with him. And the princes of the Philistines said unto him, make this fellow return, that he may go again to his place which thou hast appointed him. And let him not go down with us to battle. Lest in the battle he be an adversary to us. For wherewith should he reconcile himself unto his master? Should it not be with the head of his men? Wanted to save their lives from being destroyed with David and all his soldiers. But little did they know that it was the mercy of God that was passing through them to save the life of David. Who knows?
And
if David would have gone into this war and his men, he would have been killed. He would have been destroyed with all his men. So the mercy of God passed through these commanders of the Philistines to save David from destruction. That is the mercy of God. Because as it is commanded by God, that we hate anything that has to do with killing. In Exodus chapter 20, verse 13. The Bible says, Thou shalt not kill. That is a command from God. For anything that has to do with killing, with staining your hands with blood, God says, you should not involve yourself therein. Even if David would have died in the war, but eventually he goes into that war and begins to kill the people. He has stained his hands with blood. Let's also look at Genesis chapter 9, verse 6. Whosoever shedded man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed. For in the image of God made he man. Shed man's blood. The Bible says, from that man's blood will I require.
His
blood shall also be shed. And God hates it. Anything that has to do with shedding of blood, God is not in support. Let's also look at Proverbs chapter 6. Proverbs chapter 6, verse 16 to 17. These six things does the Lord hate. Yea, seven are an abomination unto him: a proud look, a lying tongue, and a hand that shed innocent blood. God hates shedding of blood. The Bible says these six things are an abomination unto God. They are not good. God is not happy at all. And each one of them is shedding of blood. God hates shedding of blood. Let's also look at Habakkuk chapter 2. Habakkuk 2 verse 12. Establisheth a city by iniquity. Woe to him that buildeth a city with blood. Just the same way that Abigail saved David from shedding blood. David would have built on blood as immediately he took over the throne, the mantle of leadership. And here the Bible says, anyone that builded on blood, woe unto him. When the Bible says woe, what does it mean? Great sorrows shall be upon you. Pain shall be upon you. So in as much as you have bled on top blood, you shall suffer and you shall be in pain. So God hates anything that has to do with blood. God of blood.
Oh,
let's also see Isaiah chapter 59. Isaiah chapter 59, verse number 3. Isaiah 59, verse 3. For your hands are defiled with blood, and your fingers with iniquity. Your lips have spoken lies. Your tongues has muttered perverseness. So we can see all these characteristics, all these features that have been mentioned in this Bible verse. Characteristics that were found in the life of David. Hands filled with blood. Fingers that filled with iniquity. Lips that have spoken lies and deceit. A tongue that has whispered wicked things. So in all these characteristics, God hated
it.
God hated it. And you should not defy your hands with blood. You should not use your fingers to kill. You can use your fingers to kill. So many people have written memos, they have used their hands to write papers that have killed, have sentenced so many people to death. Innocent people.
They
are not guilty of any crime or any offense. You have used your fingers to sentence them to death. Says lips that spoke lies. Through our lips, we have decided to sentence many people to death. We have killed not only by hands alone, not only by fingers, but by our lips. And above all, the tongue. That whispered wicked things. That whispered wickedness. We have used our tongue to kill. What does the Bible say concerning the power of the tongue? Let's look at Proverbs chapter 18. Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21. Proverbs 18, 21. Proverbs 18, 21. The Bible says, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit. The power of death and life lies in the tongue. So many of us today think that we can only kill with our hands. Little do we know that we can use our tongue to kill. We have used our tongue to render so many people jobless in our places of work. We have used our tongue to scatter so many people's relationships. We have used our tongue to scatter so many people's marriages. We have used our tongue to spoil so many people's businesses. That is killing. You have used your tongue to kill. So let's also look at what James said concerning the tongue. In James chapter 3. James chapter 3. I'm going to take it from verse 5. It said, even so, the tongue is a little member and boasted great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindled. Verse 6. And the tongue is a fire, a wall of iniquity. So is a tongue among our members that is defiled the whole body and set it on fire, the cause of nature, and it is set on the wall of hell. For every kind of beast and of birds and of serpent and of things in the sea is tamed and had been tamed of mankind. But the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil full of deadly poison. Even the wild, the most dangerous animals. The most dangerous animals, they can be controlled. But the tongue is very difficult to control. But as believers in the vineyard of the Lord, as believers in Christ Jesus, our tongue can be controlled. Our tongue can be tamed. We can control our tongue. We not use our tongue to kill people. Then how can we control our tongue? So you are saying James chapter 1. Verse 19. The Bible says, wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, and slow. As a believer, how can you control your tongue? James said, you should be fast to hear, or you should be slow to speak, and slow to anger. There is nothing wrong for you to hear all that you are supposed to hear. But the ability to control your tongue is what matters. Because for everyone that is fast to speak always, will always speak nonsense. And for anyone that is slow to speak, will be able to filter out the norm, and all that the person who speaks will now be sense and not nonsense. So it is common sense that whenever you want to speak, whenever you have heard all that you have heard, when you want to speak, speak sensibly. Do not speak because God has given you the tongue that is in the mouth that you are supposed to use it to talk and begin to talk nonsense. Control your tongue. Don't cause disunity between people. Don't cause separation between people. Don't cause quarrel between people with the use of the tongue. The Bible condemns it. The Bible condemns it in totality. We have seen here, let it not be that because we are enjoying the mercies of God, we will continue to sin and sin, and the mercy of God and the grace of God will abound with us. Let us not take the grace of God for granted. What did the Bible say in Romans chapter 6? Romans chapter 6, verse 1 and 2. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer? Shall we continue in sin because we are enjoying the grace of God? The Bible says God forbid. We are not supposed to continue in sin. Any appearance of evil, anything that has to do with sin, stay clear from me. Control your tongue. You are a believer. You can control your tongue. Because it's the Holy Spirit that is now in charge of your life and not you. You stay away from evil. And what did the Bible say to that effect also? In Proverbs 29, verse 20. Seest thou a man that is hasty in his ways? There is more hope of a fool than of him. There is more hope for a fool than anyone who speaks without thinking. It is better off for a fool than that kind of fellow. So control your tongue. So that the mercy of God upon your life will not be chased away. The man David that we have used as a case study today, God has shown mercy to him. And David himself is mercy himself. In all this that he has been parading, that he has been going through, killing and killing, shedding innocent blood, he realized that God heals anything that has to do with shedding of blood. Just like the choir of sang, you need to surrender. So for you to enjoy the mercy of God, what do you need to do? You need to surrender all in totality. David did that exactly. When he realized that he has been doing is wrong in the sight of God. He surrendered all to God. He said, no, I don't want to continue like this. Lord, have mercy upon me. Let's look at Psalm 51. How David surrendered in totality to God. Psalm 51 from verse 1. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according unto the multitude of thy tender mercies. Multitude of thy tender mercies. Blot out my transgression. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against thee, the only, have I sinned, and done this evil in thy sight, that thou may be justified when thou speakest, and declare when thou judgest. Behold, I was shackled in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, thou desired truth in thy inward part, and in the hidden part thou hast made me to know wisdom. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness, that the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice. Hide thy face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. This is David, a man who has realized his mistakes. He went back to God, humbly, and surrendered all to God. He said, I know I am a sinner. I know I have sinned, but have mercy on me. Because you are a merciful God. That should be our stand today. Let us not be like Adam and Eve that made a sin in the garden. And God came and asked them, have you eaten of the fruit that I said you should not eat? They begin to play blame game. The man said, is it not the woman that you gave to me? And the woman said, is it not the serpent? They begin to blame one another. But the case of David was not so. When David realized his mistakes, he surrendered all. He went back to God in humility. And God helped him. But what surprised me most is this. In that verse 11 of that Psalm 51, the Bible says, cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. This is an Old Testament believer. How will David know the importance of the Holy Spirit in the man's life? But during the Old Testament days, the Spirit of Jesus will just come upon you. And after a particular task or an assignment has been carried, the Spirit will leave you. But this is an Old Testament believer. So take not thy Holy Spirit from me. But this knows the importance of the indwelling of the Holy Spirit in a man's life. That when the Holy Spirit dwells in a man's life, the Holy Spirit will help you. He will prevent you from committing sin. Because the life you now live is a life that is being led by the Holy Spirit. Before you even say a thing, the Holy Spirit will lead you how and what to say. Well, what is happening in the New Testament believers today? They have the privilege to enjoy the indwelling of the Holy Spirit in their life. The some, they have abused that privilege or the indwelling of the Holy Spirit in their life.
They
are not doing the right thing. Because all they believe is that the mercy of God is always there and the mercy of God will speak for me. But for how long shall you continue in sin? For the mercy of God, for the grace of God to our power. You need to go back to God. Surrender all to Him.
He's
ready to forgive you.
And
take you back. The same way He did to David. After He has received David, God Himself was bold enough to say, out of the root of Jesse, I have found a man after my own heart. But because David went back and surrendered all to God. So finally, let's look at Isaiah chapter 55. Isaiah chapter 55, verse 17. Isaiah 55 verse 7, Isaiah 55 verse 7. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thought, and let him return unto the Lord, and He will have mercy upon him, and to our God He will abundantly pardon. Those who have used their fingers to kill, those who have used their lips to kill, those who have used their tongue to kill you, you need to go back to God. You need to surrender all to God. He is abundantly able to pardon you. Don't do that. You stand in great risk of being destroyed. And the mercy of God and the grace of God upon your life will leave you. So let us continue to stay in the place of righteousness. And if we have erred, if we have gone astray, we need to go back to God like David. And God will have mercy upon us. And I pray this morning that the mercy of God that we have received, we will receive it in vain in Jesus' name. Shall we rise as we pray? And say the mercy of God upon David. The mercy of God upon our life as believers. Saying how the mercy of God works in our life. But we should not abuse the mercy by constantly committing sin, by constantly shedding blood. Because today, when we talk of immorality and evil, we talk of fornication, adultery. We talk of things like committing abortion. But here today, the Bible says we can use our lips, our tongues to kill. We are going to pray this morning. It says in Romans chapter 9. I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy. I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. It is not of him that we let. It is of God that showeth mercy. It is of God that showeth mercy. It is of God that showeth mercy. Let's open our mouth and begin to cry for the mercy of God this morning. It is of God that He will show mercy on whom it pleases Him to show mercy upon. The Bible says, it is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed. It is of the mercies of God that we are not consumed. Because His compassion filled the world. And the mercies of God are new every morning in our lives.